joining us right now from The Athletic and Fox Sports to talk about the remarkable headlines from college football is our friend Bruce Feldman. How are you, Bruce?
I'm doing well, Rich. Good to be on with you.
Good to be having you here as well. Let's start with the story of the most famous player, if not the de facto Heisman Trophy winner and the number one overall pick in next year's NFL draft, Trevor Lawrence, having COVID-19. I'll give you the floor on what you think this means writ large for everyone.
Well, for in the short term, obviously, Trevor has come out and said he is experiencing mild symptoms. We hope that that's the extent of it. And look, from our reporting, I believe he was the only one who has tested positive this week on the football team at Clemson. So hopefully this is an isolated case and not one where you're seeing it in Wisconsin or, you know, saw it at Florida or Baylor or a handful of other places that have had it spread through a program. In this case, it's obviously, as you said, it's the Heisman frontrunner and the most famous college football player out there right now. He will not play this weekend against Boston College. Now, strictly from a football standpoint, next week they play what is expected to be their toughest regular season game, and that's on the road at Notre Dame. And so through the ACC's guidelines connected to the CDC, so there's basically a 10-day period where from the time that he either first experiences symptoms, which could have been actually Monday or Tuesday, or we've been told that he tested positive on Wednesday. So there is a chance he could be back in time to play in the Notre Dame game a week from Saturday. But there's a lot of TBDs right now to be sorted out on that front. And certainly, if he were to play in that game, aside from Zooms and some of those things he could do remotely, it doesn't look like he would have hardly any time, if at all, to practice with the team over the next 10 days.
Well, and then, you know, we're also just assuming that it would be just like the flu for him. You know, he'll get through it and that'll be that. And, you know, we all know that there are some people who have mild symptoms and then get through COVID-19 and can actually return to active normal life for them, whatever that means. But maybe not a game against Notre Dame, and that is entirely possible. But what does it mean, do you think, here in general for Clemson, the ACC, and everyone? Is it just like, I guess, the same thing as we're seeing in the NFL each week, that you figure out what their close contacts are, et cetera? And then I'm reading that he lives alone, so he doesn't have a roommate or anything like that to worry about.
Right, and they are testing, the rest of his teammates did get tested. So if there are no other subsequent positives, that's certainly a good development for Clemson. As you said, both he and Dabo Swinney said that he is only experiencing mild symptoms, and hopefully that's all it is. This shows that, you know, anybody in college football can get this. I mean, we've seen certainly anybody can get this, but you're seeing cases certainly in the Big Ten footprint and hospitalizations in Wisconsin especially going up, and then obviously Wisconsin is dealing with it with, I think it's now 8 staff members, including the head coach, Paul Christ. So it's just, in a way, it's stunning to see, you know, Trevor Lawrence getting it and announcing he's testing positive. But it's 2020. I don't think, especially after, like, you know, you're watching the World Series and you're like, you know, nothing should be shocking at this point.
So let's talk about Wisconsin. I'm on with Bruce Feldman of The Athletic and Fox Sports. Let's talk about Wisconsin and Graham Mertz and as you mentioned, many staff members, including the head coach, having COVID-19. The game with Nebraska has been canceled, right? It's not it's not going to be like the NFL where they're going to add a week on at the end, right? If you don't play it, it's finished.
Yeah, and Rich, it's not like there's other conferences who've had, you know, we've had to make the, not really semantics, but to say, oh, that game's been postponed. Well, these games in the Big Ten are getting canceled because there was no margin for error, no wiggle room in the schedule, just because it's all crammed in because they ended up with a later starting date, obviously October 24th, and now they're trying to get teams, hopefully for their sake, to get as many games as possible in, so then they hope that their champion could be measured accordingly with the CFP, who's going to probably have some other teams that may have more games, right? So So we'll see how this plays out. I don't, you know, it's a stretch to probably think Wisconsin's the only Big Ten program that's going to have to deal with some of these issues. Now, they do not have some of the same protocols as the other conferences who have this like 53-man roster kind of threshold. There are different thresholds they have in here, but this was a Wisconsin determination. And keep in mind, unlike Clemson right now, where it's only Trevor Lawrence and the quarterback who's tested positive, you had the guy who was the starter before Graham Mertz, Jack Cohen, is dealing with a foot injury. He's out. So then you have Graham Mertz test positive. You had Chase Wolf, the third-string quarterback, test positive. Right now, they would be down to their fourth-string quarterback. And because of the minimum 21-day period that is on players if you test positive, and again, it's a minimum, not a maximum, that they're going to be having their fourth-string quarterback, even if they can play next week against Purdue, then it's likely to be Danny Vandenberg before they have to run the offense.
Well, what are you hearing about a movement afoot potentially, Bruce, that in the same way that the Big Ten said, well, our initial decision to not play at all this fall was changed based on testing advances and testing and understanding the science a little better, that the protocol to keep a kid out 21 days if they test positive, that can be changed because now there's a different way to approach somebody who has COVID-19. Is there a movement afoot to try and loosen those restrictions, the 21-day?
Right now, Rich, there's been some chatter about it, and I'm not sure it's been that much more than that. SI.com had an interesting story 2 days ago about it. Barry Alvarez, the Wisconsin AD, was quoted in it, and Barry Alvarez is a very influential figure. And look, let's be honest, Barry Alvarez's program is the one who is right now most in the crosshairs of this kind of discussion. So, you know, when I had talked to people a week ago about this and the testing out process and some of the other things, also when it comes to, I had heard from some programs in the Big Ten, they were dealing with a bunch of false positives and what that led to. So I think there's a lot of discussion, I would call it chatter. When I had reached out to some higher up folks in the Big Ten, I did not get that they were going to, you know, pull back on what they'd already put in place. And when I asked Paul Christ on Monday about their stricter protocols in other conferences, he told me he was comfortable with it because they were part of the discussions, and that's what the doctors and the experts and the chancellors and the presidents had agreed to in order for them to play. So we'll see where this goes. I mean, it's definitely something we're going to monitor to see if there's more movement on it, but at this point, it's just kind of a talking point.
Let's talk now a little bit, Bruce Feldman, about how Nebraska tried to fill the void of their game with Wisconsin being canceled, trying to get UT Chattanooga, whose conference decided to punt to next winter, I guess. Next February is UT Chattanooga's next scheduled game. Try to get them into Nebraska to play, and the Big Ten said no to that. So let me ask you a couple questions on this one. Number one, was it not decided before the schedule began that any canceled games could not be filled in with somebody from outside the Big Ten? Wasn't that already a given?
Yeah, those discussions, I think, were had to some degree, and I don't know. You know, I think the pushback has come from Nebraska on a couple of fronts as it relates to this. And they went down the road. And I think what was significant to me to this by the Big Ten making its, you know, kind of statement on this is, as I said, a minute ago, it would not be very surprising if some other programs have postponements. Maybe they're not of their own doing where they can play, but their opponent can't. And yet they're going to say, all right, well, you know, it's not just, I mean, look, everybody watched Nebraska get thumped pretty soundly by Ohio State. The idea that Nebraska is worried about trying to get consideration for the CFP seems really far-fetched at this point. But what I think is a real consideration on their front is, one, you know, their players only get so many windows at games in the fall, and that would be obviously a nod to them, but also it's, you know, because again, the Big Ten's not like they're bringing in, fans now, so it's not like a huge gate opportunity as it is in other parts of college football. It's so from that standpoint, I don't think Nebraska is looking at going, hey, we're going to have at least we'll have a win because it's UT Chattanooga. I don't, for the most part, I don't think anyone's going to go, you know, give them a big pat on the back for that. I just think it's an opportunity for the players first and foremost. And I think that was one of the big considerations they were trying to push.
No, and I know that everybody wants reps and everyone wants games. And the point of having these games, you know, if you do want to put the finances and the fact that, you know, the Big Ten will have a marquee event for a second straight week with Fowler and Herb Street calling it. And, you know, you're checking a box with ESPN and you're checking a box about national prominence and keeping your team and your leagues right out there in front. And I totally get that Nebraska wants to have their kids play football. That's the idea of why they sued to get the attention of the Big Ten. But to try and bring somebody from out of the conference and say, you know what, we'll just test them and then throw Nebraska back in the vector of the conference after that, to me, is madness. That's the only word for it to me. And I will ask this question, you know, based again on the reporting of our colleague Dan Wetzel at Yahoo. Does Nebraska want to be in the Big Ten? Seriously. Like, do they want to be part of this?
It really doesn't feel like it at this point, to be honest, because if you go back, a couple of decades now, you know, Nebraska, as you and I both grew up around, was, you know, a powerhouse in the Big Eight. It was Nebraska and Oklahoma, and they were the heaviest of heavyweights. And then when they ended up in what was the Big 12, the power base really became Texas, right? I mean, that's kind of what it was. Texas was had more influence and everything like that, and I think Nebraska bristled at that. And over time, Nebraska's program really has backslid quite a bit. I don't want to say it's backslid into mediocrity, but it's not, I don't want to say it's irrelevant either because they have a really strong fan base and they've had some good teams and obviously had some good players. But I think this part, they have wrestled with their own place and maybe that I don't think is sitting well with a lot of folks there. And you look at this and I'm not sure what the expectation is. Would they rather be in the Big 12 right now? They left the Big 12. Is that where they'd rather be? Because I'm not sure how much different the treatment is going to be if they were on their own in another place.
Well, I, again, the reason why I ask it is, and the reason why I'm saying it's madness is we all agreed to play under these rules and protocols that I'm assuming all the Big Ten teams have in place. They agreed it's the same. The protocols are the same. And, you know, to bring in somebody from outside, even if you test them and they're negative, we all know that that doesn't mean anything specifically, you know, locked up. And I'm just wondering again, like what the whole concept is about moving forward. And if you could wave a wand, would everybody want them out in the Big Ten? And, you know, and I admitted before, Bruce, that part of this is me still upset that Michigan's national championship was halved with Nebraska back in 1997 as a gold watch to Tom Osborne to send him along into retirement. So I'll ask you this question. We're going to drag him into this, Chris? Should we do that? You wanted me to do that?
Yeah, absolutely.
Who would have won that 1997 game between Michigan and Nebraska in your estimation, Bruce?
Ooh, good question. The only thing I can say is, guess who I'm working with this weekend for Fox? The star of that team.
Which one?
Star of All-Star.
Which one? Which?
Well, the star of the one you you love the most.
Charles
the
Woodson.
One that you probably resent.
Charles Woodson, right. Okay. So answer this as honestly as possible, knowing that you do have to see the Heisman Trophy winner who would have an absolute answer probably similar to mine. But who do you think would have won that game in 97?
I really don't know. That's one I'm not copping out. I'll be honest. So much time has passed between now and then. I honestly couldn't tell you. If you asked me who did I think would have won between Miami and Washington, I would look at the talent Miami had, and as it was, and again, as an NFL team, and I would look at it and go, all right, I think Miami was the better team than that Washington team. That one, I don't know. I mean, it's, you know, I would have loved to have seen it.
Me too.
But I don't think I look at it and go, oh, yeah, Washington, I mean, Nebraska would have got beat by 2 touchdowns. It just didn't, you know, it didn't feel like those teams were that far apart.
No, they weren't. They were not that far apart. And as you know, I can personally attest to this with my recollection, that Rose Bowl was not a given either. you know, where Ryan Leaf and Washington State gave Michigan a nice run for their money.
All of it. Yeah.
All of it. But, you know, best player on the field, with the ultimate respect to the current coach, the current coach at Nebraska, Amon Green, who had an excellent career. Let's be totally honest here. I mean, the best player on the field won the Heisman Trophy over Peyton Manning, for crying out loud. And I would also pound the table. You want to talk about Hall of Famers that would have been on the field. You had one sitting right up front to protect Brian Griese. And Hutch, Steve Hutchinson was on that team. I mean, I could really go on and on about it.
But I know you could. I can see you getting worked up about this.
I am.
He's so worked up.
I am worked up about it.
But you still get to claim you're the national title. Like no one's saying you didn't win it. That's still, you still have the trophy and the thing, that you still get it on the letterhead. The fact that you share it.
But so does Nebraska.
You
know, so does Nebraska. Like, so does Nebraska. They still they can say the same thing.
There's no shame in that. Those, like, the split national title to me, and like, it's not like, you know, this isn't like we got snubbed, we didn't get the national title, you know, or whatever. I mean, like, this to me is different than, like, if Vince Young, and I don't think Vince is, you know, seething about this, but if Vince Young is pissed off because somebody at USC got his Heisman or whatever, like, he didn't get that. Now, he won a national title subsequent to that. But, like, to me, when you split the national championship, nobody can stop you from saying you're the national title team. You have the hardware. Like, you know, it's a fun argument to say who would win, and I'm sure people have done computer simulations on that game and all, but, you know, it's like, that's the, you know, look, I mean, let's not kid ourselves. It's been a long time since Michigan football has had something really to pump the fist about, you know, so at least you have that.
Wow. Ask the poll question. Have you come up with a poll question on this, Chris?
Yeah, so Bruce, based on this, which hypothetical matchup would you most have liked to have seen? So 97, Michigan-Nebraska, 03, LSU-USC, 91, Washington-Miami, 90, Georgia Tech-Colorado. See, these are all split titles.
Yeah. I don't think I didn't think anybody was beating that USC team at that point, not those, you know, those other teams. To me, the most interesting one is the one that Rich has worked up about, to be honest. I'm not just preaching to the choir. I look at that Miami team and I'm thinking, well, they're way more talented, I think, than Washington was. I know Washington was really good. I mean, the Georgia Tech CU one, it's, you know, it feels so far removed. And also, by the way, those are programs, it's like, let them have those, you know, those national titles in terms of that. Cause I mean, look where those programs are right now, right? CU has been a mess for a long time, and Georgia Tech has been pretty far down the last couple of years. So I don't know. The Nebraska Michigan one would be the one I would be most interested to watch play out. Cause I think that's the one that's the biggest toss up.
Okay. Bruce, I appreciate the chat and I appreciate the conversation here as well. Be safe. Say hi to Charles. Are you here in L.A. working with him? Are you going anywhere?
Yeah, we're gonna have a meeting probably in like 2 hours, and then we're on. Come watch us tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. Eastern on Fox. Yeah,
fantastic. We will be there. You take care of yourself. Oh, and that's leading up to Michigan State, correct?
It is. So I know you'll be watching at least for the first half.
I will be because, you know, nothing excites me more settling into a Michigan game to hear what Urban Meyer thinks. Can't wait. That'll be great. Can't wait.
Charles is on there, though. So, look, you get to see Joe Milton in this offense. Why would people not want to see that?
Hey, Urban is my BFF. You ask him. You tell him I said hi, okay? We've watched some Super Bowls together, he and I. We've spent some time. He spent the time in a draft with me. I had to sit at the end of the set while he's sitting there as a Cheshire Cat, watching one Ohio State guy after another get drafted in Chicago, and that draft in Chicago where they set a record for most draftees through the first three rounds, and Michigan had one, finally, at the end of that Friday night.
By the way, I can't ask him this because I honestly don't know. He may deep down really resent you, and I don't want to go there with him.
No, we're good. We are fine. And I was just joking. I will be there with bells on getting ready to watch Michigan take on a Michigan State team that turned it over seven times to Rutgers. I can't wait. This will be great. Great start to my Saturday tomorrow.
Perfect.
You take care of yourself, Bruce. Thanks for the call.
You too.
Hey, you watched all the way to the end. Thanks for that. Watch more right here.